website in official Turkish sources. Third, the documentation of the Armenian genocide in official German sources. Fourth, the reconstruction of the Armenian genocide on the basis of this documentation. And fifth, a theoretical summary, a review of the Armenian genocide in terms of a theory, contribution to a theory of genocide. Number one, introduction. The Armenian genocide has many similarities with several other genocides, in particular the Holocaust of the Jews. But in one major respect, it is a very distinct type of genocide, primarily, if not exclusively, because of its persistent and insistent denial by Turkish authorities. This function of denial, which I consider a function of power, only powerful people can afford to deny, has several elements which need to be reviewed before I proceed to the rest of my presentation. What are the constituent elements of the Turkish denial of the Armenian genocide? There are four major components of the Turkish denial of the genocide. Number one, it is argued that essentially what happened to the Armenians was within the framework of what is called deportations, tehcir. Secondly, it is argued that the term genocide is unwarranted because only a segment of the Armenian population in the war zones was subjected to deportation. Number three, it is argued that it couldn't be genocide because it was mutual massacre. Armenians massacred Turks, Turks massacred Armenians, therefore it was sort of mutual atrocities. And fourth, because of this, it is argued that it was not genocide but rather civil war in the context of the global war. Because of the rest of my presentation, I cannot afford to go into details of these elements of denial. But briefly, let me suggest the following. I think the idea that it was merely deportation, and even the word deportation today is being subjected to review and revision, because we have now invented a new word as part of denial. It's called relocation. In other words, the benevolent Ottoman government was so solicitous of the welfare of the Armenians that it provided shelter and food for hundreds of thousands of people deported to the deserts of Mesopotamia. even the chief of staff of the 4th Turkish Army, General Fuat, he was the chief of staff of the 4th Army, commanded by Cemal Pasha, with headquarters in Aleppo, in his book, Memoirs of World War I, ridiculed the idea of relocation, saying, relocation? What relocation? In the deserts of Mesopotamia, hundreds of thousands of people providing food and shelter, and therefore, all of people who are responsive to the Turkish argument that this was a nice resettlement project, I advised them to read General Fuat's book, Memoirs, Birinci Harp Hatıraları. Secondly, the idea that it was only a portion of the Armenian population in the war zones subject to deportation is flatly contradicted by numerous Turkish sources, indicating that with the exception of Istanbul and Izmir and parts of Konya, the rest, Kütahya, the rest of the Armenian population of the entire Ottoman Empire was subject to deportation, including European Turkey, Trakya in Edirne, and also Tekirdağ. I think I like to dwell briefly on the main Turkish argument of mutual atrocities and therefore a civil war argument. By any definition, civil war suggests the collapse of a central government And therefore, a vacuum is created, and in that vacuum, armed groups fight against each other. I submit to you that during World War I, the central authority of the Ottoman Empire was anything but collapsed. On the contrary, it was reinforced by new arrangements, such as like the Nazis did in World War II. They eliminated the Reichstag, the German parliament. The same happened in Turkey. The Ottoman parliament was dissolved by Talat Pasha. The entire power was shifted to the executive group. General mobilization was declared. In ours, the central authority was not only live and strong, it was powerful and reinforced. There was no vacuum of central authority to allow the rise and the creation of civil war. This is the most absurd, untenable argument. And then consider the following fact. With general mobilization, male Armenian population in the group 20 to 45 was conscripted in the Ottoman army. What was left was women, old men, and children. To think that these destitute people, deprived of their menfolk, would dare to confront the powerful Ottoman army and engage in civil war for 4 years. Think of it. What are the limits of absurdity of an argument of civil war? Therefore, I don't think it's even worth to discuss this whole thing. The entire structure of Turkish denial is predicated upon hollow and superficial arguments, untenable by any logic or historical documentation. And I think it is a function of power. Only powerful people can afford to deny. Therefore, allow me to confront this 75 years of enduring Turkish denial, to confront and compare with a very interesting period of post-war Turkish history, Ottoman history, which underscores the significance of the switch from admission of guilt to total denial. In the period of 1918, October 1918, until early 1920, when Kemalism began to get hold in Anatolia, for this period of 2 years, Turkey was very much like Germany after World War II. Turkish newspapers, Turkish publicists, even Turkish military, admitting, confessing guilt, saying what a great crime we committed against the Armenian people. The great Turkish emancipator Halide Edip, in the Turkish newspaper Vakıt, in several editorials, deplored the tragedy of the Armenian people, saying that the innocent population was victimized. In other words, if you study Turkish press, Turkish books, Turkish parliamentary debates, you see confession after confession. A defeated, debilitated Turkey was in the mood of confession. And how interesting it is for history and political science to observe that how this framework of guilt, admission, repentance can transform itself into defiance and denial by the acquisition of power. As soon as Kemalism gained the foothold in Anatolia, this entire mood of Turkish confession, Turkish admission of guilt, Turkish willingness to make even a Turkish wartime minister of economy, Javid, is on record saying that not only we committed a crime, we owe reparations to the Armenians. This was the mood, ladies and gentlemen, in Turkey, 1918-1920, before the rise of Kemalism. Now, in the light of this fact, that before a defiant, rebellious Kemalist movement, and if I were a Turk, I would celebrate Mustafa Kemal. I think he's a great national hero. He transformed a major military defeat into a major military spectacular victory, and because of that, history is suffering, because that gave them the arrogance to Turkish historians to deny the great crime of genocide. Now, I'd like to proceed then with the problem of documentation of the Armenian genocide in the light of evidence supplied by these conditions I outlined: defeat, demoralization, and admission of guilt. I think the fact that the denial of the Turkish genocide, Armenian genocide, is unrelenting, I submit to you that the documentation of the Armenian genocide acquires a major significance. In other words, we cannot afford simply to document the genocide, but it has to be a kind of documentation that is what I call compelling. It precludes any possibility of denial. In other words, Armenian historians, because of denial, are obligated to provide the kind of documentation that compels, that provides no alternative to admission of guilt. So what is the definition of compelling evidence? In my definition of compelling evidence, there are four constituent elements. Number one, the evidence has to be reliable. Number two, it has to be explicit. Number three, it has to be incontestable. And number four, it has to be verifiable. Let me give you illustrations about these four constituent elements of compelling evidence. Reliable. I would submit to you, and as I have indicated in my outline, you have observed that I didn't mention any Armenian sources of evidence. Armenians are victims, and therefore, by definition, they are suspect. Even the multitudes of Armenian survivors' accounts are very powerful documents, but because they are victims, the problem of bias is a problem. Therefore, I dispense with the utilization of Armenian sources. They are, by definition, not reliable. So what is left? Turkish documentation, German documentation, Austrian documentation. The reason I am mentioning German and Austria, because let me remind you that during World War I, Imperial Germany and Imperial Austria were the political and military allies of the Ottoman Empire. Therefore, the documentation has extraordinary significance. It is the documentation coming from the allies of Ottoman Empire. So let me give you an illustration by what is reliable evidence. The American Council of Harwood, Leslie, wrote a book about the genocide. And the centerpiece of that book is eyewitness account of the horrendous massacres of women and children in Harwood province. His assistant was a Turk, and this Turk told him that he has now evidence that all the Armenians are being taken out, supposedly to be deported to Mesopotamia outside Harput city, are being bayoneted by Turkish soldiers. And he wanted to see in person. So not an Armenian, but a Turkish employee of the American consulate in Harput served as a guide. He took him to all the sites of atrocities, and the American consul personally observed the naked bodies of, he says, thousands and thousands of Armenian women and children bayoneted to death in naked position. And he said he spent 12 hours inspecting the sites of atrocities of the Armenian population of Harput. Now, to me, this can be no more than most reliable documentation. It's a neutral American diplomat, and his guide is a Turk. What is explicit, the second condition of compelling evidence? explicit means, was it deportation or was it massacre or was it both? There is a difference, ladies and gentlemen, between true deportation, wartime exigency, and deportation as an instrument for ultimate objective of massacre of the deportee population. The documentation that I'm going to supply to you abounds with evidence that the purpose of deportation was the destruction of the deportee population. Out of more than 1.5 million Armenians, there are only 60,000 Armenians left in Turkey today. What kind of deportation, what kind of relocation is this? The third element, incontestable, is that it leaves no room, it leaves no dispute about the fact of the crime of mass murder. And I will shortly supply to you concrete specific references to that. And finally, I think the most important aspect of verifiability. You can make innumerable arguments denying, confirming, affirming, protesting, but if you are in no position to supply documentation that is verifiable, it is useless. Turkish documentation. Well, I refer to you to this period of 1918-1920. This may be unpleasant truth for Turks who keep denying, this is the most embarrassing period for Turkish denialists, because 1918-1920 is a period replete with Turkish documentation of the Armenian genocide. If you study the newspapers of that period, and we are doing it now, it is replete with Turkish eyewitnesses narrating the cruel massacre of helpless women and children. There are three types of authentic Turkish documentation. Number one, parliament. Number two, a parliamentary commission specially created to investigate the massacres. Number three, the Turkish court-martials. The Turkish court-martials are the most compelling source of Turkish documentation. It is most significant that after the march of the Kemalist forces in Istanbul, Turkey, in late 1922, these powerful archives of the Turkish military tribunal vanished, disappeared. Nobody knows what happened to them. But for 18 months, the Turkish court-martial acquired, validated, and documented the Armenian genocide. And we have material about this. So the Turkish documentation is then, number one, debates in the parliament. Number two, a parliamentary commission created specifically for this purpose. And then the Turkish court martial. Let me briefly outline these three elements. In the Turkish parliament, in the months of November, December, on December 21, the Turkish Chamber of Deputies was closed by the Sultan because of the predominance of Ittihadist deputies who were trying to sabotage the investigation. So according to Article 7 of the Ottoman Constitution, he had the power to dissolve the Chamber of Deputies, not the Senate. But before then, for about 2 months, deputy senators, one after another, came to the podium and explicitly admitted the mass murder of the Armenians. Let me give you one or two examples. On October 19, 1918, the president of the Ottoman Senate, Ahmet Riza, a former Ittihadist leader, went to the podium and openly declared that the Armenians were savagely killed. He used the word, Turkish word, vahşiyane, savagely killed. 2 days later, he was challenged by a retired general, Osman Pasha, saying that, why are you excluding the Turks? The Turks were killed too. And Ahmed Riza gave a very significant response 2 days later, October 21, 1918. He said, yes, some Turks were killed too, but there's a big difference. The Armenians were killed by the state, organized by the Ottoman state. Armenian acts of murders against Turks were individual acts of revenge following the mass murder of the Armenians. One was individual acts of revenge, the other was state-organized mass murder, and Osman Pasha shut up. On November 21, 1918, in the same Ottoman Senate, Reshid Akif Pasha, the most distinguished Ottoman statesman, he was governor of Sivas province, he was the chief of state council, Devlet Shura, he was a very respected man, and still today, in Turkish historical books, he is a revered person, as a very decent Ottoman statesman. On November 21, 1918, Reshid Akif Pasha, in the Senate of the Ottoman Parliament, made the following declaration. He said, immediately after World War I, I was appointed president of the State Council, Shura-i Devlet. State Council is an intermediary thing between the Chamber of Deputies and the Senate that deals with legislative acts. This is a very highly respected organ of the Ottoman Parliament, mostly legislative, and he was the president of the Council of State. On November 21, 1918, and gentlemen, ladies and gentlemen, I'm quoting all these things because these are recorded in the proceedings of the Ottoman Parliament. They are printed and available today to anyone who wants to study. I have the collection of all these debates in the Ottoman Parliament printed in Latin characters in Ottoman language. On November 21, 1918, Reshid Akif Pasha made this sensational declaration in the Ottoman Senate. He said, as I was discharging my functions as a president of the State Council, two types of documents came to my attention in my office. One was the formal order of Interior Minister Talat about deportation of the Armenian population. But he said the other one, almost simultaneously issued, was an unofficial order, not from any governmental agency, but the Central Committee of the Yangtze Ittihad Party, which was very brief. It was a circular issued by the Central Committee of the dominant Yangtze Ittihad Party saying, as soon as the Armenian deportee convoys leave the major centers of population and are sufficiently removed from observation, proceed with the execution of your mission. And the mission was, Reshid Akif Pasha says, attack and massacre the members of the convoys. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a senator, the president of the Czech Council of State, making a public declaration in the Ottoman Parliament saying that he personally observed two types of orders. And this is the problem today of Turkish denial. They are using this Talat Pasha cipher saying, provide alleys, provide bread to the deportees, take care of them, the official order. Then the unofficial source, more powerful than the state organ, destroy the convoys. Most significantly, the revelation made by Ottoman deputy on December 11, 1918. Now, as you know, the Ottoman Parliament had two chambers, the upper chamber, the Senate, and the lower chamber, Chamber of Deputies, which is the more important body, branch of the government. because it is in charge of legislation and it is more powerful. The Senate is mostly a collection of retired people. So in the Chamber of Deputies on December 11, 1918, a Turkish deputy from province of Trabzon, Hafız Mehmet, a lawyer by profession, made the following declaration, and this too is recorded in the official gazette of the Ottoman Parliament. He said, I, deputy of Trabzon, and I should add that Hafız Mehmet was a lawyer by profession, and this enhances the significance of his testimony, and nobody compelled him to make this confession. It was totally voluntary. He said, I, deputy of Trabzon, personally saw how during World War I, in the port city of Ordu and the Black Sea, Armenian women and children were brought to the port, loaded into barges, which then took off to the high seas. They were drowned in the Black Sea, and 2 hours later came empty. Think of it, a deputy of the Ottoman Chamber of Deputies, a member of parliament, officially declaring in the Ottoman parliament that he was an eyewitness of drowning operation. And then he added, these operations, drowning operations, continued throughout the province, not only alone. And he said, I went to the Governor General, Vali Cemal Azmi, and protested. I said, as a deputy of the Ottoman Chamber, I protest, what right do you have to do this? And he was dismissed by Cemal Azmi. And he said, he went to Istanbul to protest to Interim Minister Talat, and again he was dismissed. What more do you want, ladies and gentlemen? In the Ottoman Parliament, a deputy, an eyewitness of the most horrendous aspect of the Armenian genocide, because in the Black Sea coast, in Trabzon, in Rize, in Tripoli, and in Samsun, and Ünye, tens of thousands of Armenians were drowned in the Black Sea. And here is a deputy testifying formally in the Ottoman Parliament. So much for parliamentary debates. Now, I like to proceed to the more significant aspect of Turkish documentation, which is the fifth committee, Beşinci Şube Tahkikat Komisyonu. So much for parliamentary debates. Now, I like to proceed to the more significant aspect of Turkish documentation, which is the fifth committee, Beşinci Şube Tahkikat Komisyonu. A deputy, an Arab deputy, Fuat, introduced a motion in the Chamber of Deputies on November 4, 1918, 10 points. He wanted to official investigation of the crimes perpetrated during World War I, and there were 10 points. Some of them dealt with illegal profiteering, but number 5 and number 10 of these 10 points dealt with the Armenian deportations and massacres. The fifth was about the special organization, convicts released from the prisons who were in charge of massacres, and the tenth was illegal activities of deportation. So the motion passed, and then according to Ottoman Constitution, the fifth committee, the Chamber of Deputies had 12 subcommittees and then 5 committees. So a committee was formed of deputies to investigate the Armenian deportations and massacres, among other things. All members of the two Turkish wartime cabinets were interrogated in writing and orally for about 7 weeks. Cabinet minister after cabinet minister and two Sheikhul Islams were interrogated by this fifth committee consisting of about 22 members. There were 45 members, but the rest were absent, so about 20 to 21 members were present for about several weeks, interrogating day in, day out, these wartime Turkish cabinet ministers. And there's not enough time to go into detail, but let me point out to you what two important cabinet ministers revealed in the course of this investigation. Justice Minister Ibrahim admitted during interrogation that on the instance of War Minister Enver and Interior Minister Talat, large numbers of convicts were released from the prisons for massacre duty. Think of it. A wartime justice minister admitting that he was pressured by the two architects of the Armenian genocide, War Minister Enver and Interior Minister Talat, to release convicts. And in the Ottoman Constitution, there's a provision that convicts cannot be used for military service. But they manipulated the Senate, the parliament. They came and said that they are urgently needed. And they never, and one of them, the chief of Department 2 of the Ottoman headquarters, admitted that they were used for non-front military duties. In other words, instead of for the intended purpose of serving on the front lines, he admitted that they were used for other reasons, for other purposes. He used patriotic service. And we know that the bulk of the Armenian massacres was perpetrated by these convicts released from the prisons of the Ottoman Empire. So, this is the Justice Minister Ibrahim saying that he used the word significant number of convicts were released from the prisons. Then, the most sensational admission in this fifth committee investigation was made by Grand Vizier Said Halim Pasha. The title Grand Vizier corresponds to Prime Minister. Said Halim Pasha, and this is also recorded and published, at one point he said, I, the head of the Ottoman cabinet, we issued a decree for the deportation of the Armenian population. But then he added, but he said, we ordered deportation, but we didn't say kill the deportees. This is what he exactly said. Deportation was not an order to you that you should kill the deportees. This too is recorded. Then he said, when I protested to Interior Minister Talat, he ignored me. I asked material, I asked documentations to what is being done with the Armenian deportations. He ignored. Think of it. He is an interior minister by status. He is a subordinate to the prime minister, the Grand Vizier. And he's ignoring the request of his boss, the prime minister, to supply material and to answer to the charges that the deportees are being massacred. So much for the fifth committee of the investigation. These two, the minutes of the entire proceedings of the fifth investigative committee are published and available today, both in Ottoman Turkish and modern Turkish. Finally, I come to the most important aspect of Turkish documentation, the Turkish court-martial. So much for the fifth committee of the investigation. These two, the minutes of the entire proceedings of the fifth investigative committee are published and available today, both in Ottoman Turkish and modern Turkish. Finally, I come to the most important aspect of Turkish documentation, the Turkish court-martial. It is a veritable mine of documentation, because prior to the court-martial, there was created an inquiry commission headed by a former Turkish Governor General Massar Inquiry Commission. This commission spent about 7 weeks collecting material for prosecution. As you know, for a criminal prosecution to be valid, it has to have a pre-trial investigation. The purpose of a pre-trial investigation is to determine whether there is sufficient evidence to go to proceed with trial. This was the purpose of the Massar Inquiry Commission, to see whether they could have sufficient evidence to proceed with court-martial. And Massar Inquiry Commission amassed an enormous documentary material. Enormous. And fortunately, some of this material survived because Armenian employees of the Massar Inquiry Commission copied some of the documents at night, and they are available today in the Jerusalem Armenian Patriarchate archives. You can't find them in Turkey today. I give you an example of what kind of documentation the Massar Inquiry Commission acquired in order to proceed with court martials. From one province, Ankara province alone, 42 documents were supplied to Massar Inquiry Commission. Most of these documents deal with telegraphic exchange between two Turkish military commanders. The deputy commander of the 5th Army Corps in Ankara is communicating with the deputy commander of the 15th Division stationed in Kayseri. And they are exchanging. The deputy commander of the 5th Ankara is the superior of the commander of the Kayseri's 15th Division. and they have ciphers that have been deciphered. For instance, one cipher telegraph says, today, 340 Armenians from this village have been deported, and before their destination, they were killed. Cut the dealer. Original telegraph cipher says that is, they were dispatched to their destination. The commander in Ankara ciphers while saying, what do you mean, dispatched to their destination, Mürettep Dernesev? The answer comes within 1 hour. He says, cut the dealer, they were killed. Think of it. Here's an official document between two military commanders in which Armenians are being deported. First, there's a cover language, Mürettep Dernesev, dispatched to a destination. Then upon the insistence of the commander, the code word is dismissed, and then the real word is used. They were killed off. Deportation ends with killing of the deportees. So the tribunal acquired dozens and dozens of kind of ciphers between two military commanders exchanging concrete data as to what happens to the Armenian deportees. And these were used in the court-martial. This is from Ankara province alone, 42. Now, ladies and gentlemen, today, many Turks are trying to dismiss these documents, saying that this was defeated Turkey, there was the pressure of the French and the English, the occupying forces, and therefore the authenticity of these documents are subject to question. Precisely for this reason, the Turkish court-martial authorities did something which needs to be repeated again and again to all those who keep denying the genocide. Before being used in the trial, each and every document were scrutinized by competent authorities in the Interior Ministry to verify whether or not it's authentic. And following verification, on top of each document, on the right hand of the document, on the corner, The following step was used. It conforms to the original. In Turkish, aslına muvafıktır. There you have it. Wartime documents, which have nothing to do with post-war politics. Wartime documentation authenticated by Turkish officials. And let me add to you that most of these Interior Ministry officials were Young Turk, İttihat ve Terakki Parti partisans. But they had no choice but to verify. In other words, the Interior Ministry, Justice Ministry, the police, they were all holdovers of the old criminal regime, İttihat ve Terakki Parti. And yet they verified, they authenticated documents. This authentication of wartime documents is the most crucial aspect of Turkish documentation. It transcends all arguments of politics. Now, during the trial, during the court-martial trial, initially they were all military commanders. Court-martials are military tribunals. Initially they were mixed, but within months it became entirely militarized. So they were representative of the war ministry. The prosecutor was misrepresentative of the Justice Ministry, and the documentation verification came from the interior. It was an entirely Turkish business. At the end, verdicts were issued, and I will deal with them shortly. But this is the essence of Turkish documentation: parliamentary debates, a parliamentary commission, and then court-martial. Let me now move to the second pillar of documentation, the German documentation, because I have a lot more to say and I have to be brief. The German documentation has extraordinary significance because, as I mentioned before, Imperial Germany was a military and political ally of Ottoman Turkey. Let me now move to the second pillar of documentation, the German documentation, because I have a lot more to say and I have to be brief. The German documentation has extraordinary significance because, as I mentioned before, Imperial Germany was a military and political ally of Ottoman Turkey. It is inconceivable, ladies and gentlemen, that during the war, an ally would dare to blaspheme, to accuse falsely an ally. It's inconceivable. As a matter of fact, German consuls, German ambassadors went out of their way to conceal the mass murder for several weeks. But they reached a point where concealment was no longer possible. Why? Because the German consuls deployed in the interior of Turkey, in Trabzon, in Harput, in Adana, but above all in Erzurum, were recording and reporting week after week the details of the unfolding Armenian genocide. So Turkish German ambassadors felt compelled to finally tell Berlin that this is not an ordinary deportation, this is centrally organized mass murder. A more important feature of German documentation is the following fact. All these German reports sent from Erzurum, Trabzon, Adana, Harput, went to Istanbul and then to Berlin. And all of them had the following four categories: confidential, highly confidential, secret, and top secret. In other words, these reports, ladies and gentlemen, I underscore this point, were not intended for public consumption. They were intended for internal use, for the eyes of high governmental officials. In other words, if you remove the fact that they were not intended for publicity, This enhances the power of the document that it was not distorted, a German official performing his duties, informing his superiors what he witnessed, what he saw, what the facts are. So there was no tinge, no element of desire for propaganda. It was purely internal working arrangement among German officials. And in all the German documentation, and I have been to Bonn, well, the archives were there almost 17 times, and I have hundreds and hundreds of documents. And you know what is the most significant feature of all those documents? No German consul, no German ambassador ever, or if they do, very rarely use the twin word deportation. It's all Armenian massacres, Ausschlachtung, Vernichtung, the German words. You rarely come across the word deportation in German documentation. The heart of the matter was not deportation, was destruction of the deportee population. And German documentation abounds, I underscore the word, with the word Vernichtung, Ausrottung. I can hardly find the German word for deportation in hundreds of reports issued from Erzurum, the epicenter of the Armenian genocide, then from Adana and Trabzon. Even the consul in Trabzon, a very Turkophile official. Among the German consuls, he was the most Turkophile, committed to the ideas of Young Turk Communist Party. But even he, in one point, said, I feel compelled to inform my government that this is not ordinary deportation. And he ridiculed the idea of relocation. He said the purpose, the central purpose is the obliteration of the Armenian population, period. Now, I'm skipping now Austrian documentation because Austria was also a political and military ally of Ottoman Empire, but they are almost duplication of what the Germans said. Let me move now in the light of all this, what I call compelling evidence, to the third part, reconstruction of the Armenian genocide. In the light of all this documentation, let me move now in the light of all this, what I call compelling evidence, to the third part, reconstruction of the Armenian genocide. In the light of all this documentation, what is the framework within which we may analyze the Armenian genocide as a historical fact? I see four elements in the organization and the execution of the Armenian genocide. Number one, premeditation. Number two, genocidal intent. Number three, organization of the genocide. Number four, the implementation or execution of the genocide. Let me briefly review these four elements. Premeditation. In criminal justice, ladies and gentlemen, premeditation is considered in all judicial systems, criminal systems, the most serious crime. Is there any evidence that the Armenian genocide had elements of premeditation? I can cite again authentic Turkish sources, but also German sources. I think the most significant Turkish source is in the key indictment of the Turkish Military Tribunal. In the Turkish key indictment, and then in three verdicts, Harput verdict, Yozgat verdict, Trabzon verdict, the Ottoman court martial uses an Arabic Turkish word which translates exactly for premeditation, which is the Arabic word ta'ammüdün. Ta'ammüdün is by prior design. by prior intent. So this word is used three times in the Yozgat, Chabzon, and Harput verdict, as well as in the key indictment. The key indictment of the Turkish Military Tribunal is the most powerful documentation, to which is attached 42 authenticated documents. In the Turkish Ottoman criminal justice system, which is modeled after the French system, it is inquisitorial. The judges, the prosecutors have immense power to acquire documentation and to use it. So in the Turkish key indictment, there are 42 authenticated documents attached to it. And in that key indictment, there is a key Arabic Turkish word denoting the idea of premeditation. How the Turkish word is how the fasl, carefully deliberated. Dr. Nazım is quoted there. Dr. Nazım is one of the architects of the Armenian genocide. How the fasl, prior deliberation of the crime, and then in the verdicts. Then I think you have a very important German source for premeditation, which is very important because this is a German officer, Colonel Stange, who was the only high-ranking German officer who was attached to the Third Ottoman Army operating in the eastern provinces of Turkey. Colonel Stange was very Turkophile man, and many special organization people worked for him, the commanders of a special organization. He was in charge of a portion of the Third Army that was operating in the frontier regions of Ottoman Turkey. Colonel Stange reached a point where he said, "I can no longer remain silent." In September 21st, 1915, he prepared a lengthy report for his government, in which he begins saying that, "I'm sorry, I can no longer remain silent as to what is happening to the Armenians." And he explicitly, and I have the entire text of his report, 13 pages, detailed report, identifying the perpetrators of the Third Army. He says, under the guise of deportation, the Armenian population is being destroyed. And then he used the Turkish German word, which is the exact translation of premeditation. He said, "Einen lang gehegten Plan," which means long before prepared plan, premeditation. He is a German colonel attached to the Ottoman Third Army, in charge of a particular regiment, operating for months and months, and reaching a point where he can no longer remain silent, and he's informing his government about the centrally organized, premeditated mass murder of the Armenians. I can mention several more, but brevity of time forced me now to move to the second point, which is the most important thing, genocidal intent. I can mention several more, but brevity of time forced me now to move to the second point, which is the most important thing, genocidal intent. In the definition of the United Nations Convention on Genocide, intent is critical, because you can destroy inadvertently and there can be no original intent. Was there an intent to destroy the deportee population? And here we have documentation. And you know what? The documentation comes from the commander-in-chief of the Ottoman Third Army, Vehip Pasha. Mahmud Kamil Pasha finished the genocide between April 1915 and February 1916, he was recalled back to the defense ministry in Istanbul, and he was replaced by Vehip Pasha. And I'm sorry, I make signal to cut short because this is very important element. Why Rehim Pasha became commander-in-chief after the genocide was finished? Enver, the commander-in-chief, Enver appointed Vahim, his classmate, to the Third Army from the very beginning in 1915, February. But Behat and Shakir, Dr. Nazım and Talat prevailed upon Enver, saying, we want Mahmud Kamil Pasha instead of Behat and Shakir. And Enver yielded. And it was Mahmud Kamil Pasha, General Mahmud Kamil Pasha, who organized and implemented the genocide of the Armenians in the eastern provinces of Turkey. The bulk of the Armenian population was destroyed in the command zone of the Third Army under the supervision of Mahmud Kamil Pasha. And when he finished, Rehim Pasha was appointed. And Rehim Pasha prepared the report on December 11, 1918, for the court-martial, in which he uses exactly the same word. He says the deportation and massacre of the Armenians was centrally organized by the Central Committee of the Young Turk Ottoman Party. And he uses the very important Turkish word, which is intention, kasten. He says the Armenians were murdered kasten by prior deliberation, and hükümetin tahtı altında, under the supervision of the government. Ladies and gentlemen, what more powerful document do you want? A functioning Third Army commander, a Turk of Albanian extraction, prepares a long report saying that there was deliberate intent to destroy, and it was the supervision under the supervision of the government. In any event, this is premeditation. Intention, genocide, organization, I don't, because I'm being signaled to cut short, the organization of the Armenian genocide was a very interesting element of the Armenian genocide because it resembles what happens to the Jews in Nazi Germany. The Central Committee Party created special cadres of party functionaries, former military officers who resigned from the military and became three types of functionaries of the party. Katibi, Mesul, Murahas, and inspectors, delegates and responsible secretaries were sent to the provinces, to all the centers of deportation massacres to supervise over the organization and implementation of the genocide. And they had so much power that they could veto the decision of the local provincial governors. For instance, in Trabzon, the Greek bishop interceded with the governor, saying that at least the old woman, sick men, children, temporarily exempt from deportation. He was bribed and he agreed. As soon as the representative of the party learned about this, he vetoed the decision. He said all Armenians, without exception, have to be subject to deportation. That was the centrally organized by the party. And finally, the execution. Here, you see something unprecedented in recorded history. The Young Turk Party emptied the main prisons of the Ottoman Empire, creating the most bloodthirsty criminals for massacre duty. In their deliberations, they said that during Abdülhamit region, that many officers, many soldiers had pity, therefore they spared many people. We want all Armenians destroyed, therefore we need criminals. This was the organization of the four parts, implementation. And now, I'd like to say a final word in terms of theoretical construction. What do we learn from all this? I think in terms of theoretical contribution, the following points need to be made. Number one, I think the Armenian genocide is not possible to study without studying its antecedents. Because prior to World War I, there were two major cycles of genocide, massacre in the Ottoman Empire, 1894, 1896, 100 to 150,000 Armenians were massacred during a period of several days. In 1909, about 23,000 Armenians were massacred in Adana. What happened? None of these cycles of crimes were ever prosecuted and there was no punishment. My suggestion is that the impunity attending the massacres of 19th century and the massacres of 1909 Adana became a powerful impetus for the organizers of the Turkish Armenian genocide to proceed with the planning, that they escaped punishment before and they felt that once more they will experience impunity. Finally, this is my conclusion. When we single out the most important factor, the determinant in the Armenian genocide, a very interesting feature emerges for attention and study, which resembles what happened to the Jews in Nazi Germany. Namely, not the organs of the central Ottoman government, but the highly mobilized political, autonomous political, monolithic political party who took charge of the government, Yangtar İttihat Party, was this idea of premeditation, organization, and execution. Therefore, if you want to study the Armenian genocide, you have to shift the attention from the organs of the state to the highly sophisticated organization of the Yangtar İttihat Party. İttihat ve Terakki Party, Central Committee, is absolutely and categorically the main agent of responsibility. And in conclusion, I like to say that if you ask the question, what is the intention of purpose of a genocide, I would say that here genocide emerges not a final end in itself, but as a means to an ultimate end, namely to restructure Ottoman society by transforming a highly heterogeneous society into a more or less homogeneous society, that is, purge of Christians, Jews, and the more or less monolithic, homogeneous, more or less Islamic society. Thank you.